Well, good morning. Salutations there, Pipe Pounds. Got a Dunhill burning right here. Nothing but burning love here, this Dunhill. I think it's got some Twisted Flake in there, or Navy Flake, I can't remember which. And some autumnal coffee, and here I am. Good morning to you, and happy Veterans Day. I also want to salute the United States Marine Corps' 241st birthday. Yep, old me and Archibald Henderson, back in 1775 when we got this party started. I can tell you, it was a rare old time to be a Marine back then. Of course, you know, we're talking about the young breed today, but us old Marines, you know, we still remember back when we first started back in 1775. So anyway, so hoist whatever libation you like, or light up a cigar, or fire up a pipe, and celebrate the Marine Corps' 241st birthday. You know, as well as we also honor all of our veterans of all of our foreign wars and other mission-keeping enterprises throughout history and the world. Okay. Well, I am going to venture out in some very turbulent waters this morning. I'm going to share my post-election comments with y'all. Some of you may have gotten a chance to see my election predictions, which were wrong. I really, truly believe that Mrs. Clinton was going to win, and I told you why. And it seems that it's interesting that a lot of people, there's a lot, as you don't need me to say it, a lot of consternation in the country around this recent election. But as I reflect on Veterans Day, and I shared this morning with the congregation, when I was in Bosnia, and again, I was never in a combat zone, and I was never, I wouldn't say I was ever really I was in a hazardous duty area, that's what they considered Bosnia when I was there. But I was never in combat, so, but for all of you veterans who have literally served in a combat zone and were in combat and had to endure the rigors and the horrors and the deprivations of combat, I certainly salute you, and I want to offer you my sincere thanks to you for preserving our way of life. A lot of people don't realize that when you have a deeply divided country, say like Bosnia, with the warring factions of the Serbs and the Muslims and the Croats, literally tearing each other, killing each other on wholesale, we don't really appreciate it. We don't appreciate the peace. Yes, we are in a bit of a post-election trauma, but for some, and again, I question what's really sparking this, other than they didn't get their way and a bunch of crybabies, a bunch of social justice crybabies who have no concept. I mean, look at it this way, you know. Let's just look back at one of our greatest, times of real heroism and self-sacrifice, Normandy, you know, D-Day. Look at these young people compared now to these young people, you know. These young people want to destroy America, or at least the way we understand it. They want to burn flags. And that's within their rights, I will be honest. That's within their rights. I don't say burn flags, burn pipe tobacco, that's better. But look at the other way of these other young people and what they did with the American flag, okay? Just saying. So the problem is that we have a lot of division in our country, but we don't appreciate the fact that we do, at least today, at least as I'm speaking, now it could all blow up because of the anarchy that's now prevalent in our society. But basically, we effect political change not through the bayonet, not through violence, but through the ballot box and the vote. And the people voted on Tuesday evening, of a Tuesday, and the elections came back, and Wednesday morning we had a new president, President-elect Donald Trump. As the and again, as these two gentlemen, who clearly could not be further on the opposite ends of the spectrum, at least attempt to try and come together, so shouldn't we? You know, I think we should make an effort. Now, again, we live in very highly charged political environment, and again, part of what you hear me say over and over and over again is that the way to resolve these conflicts is not to shut out or drown out or shout out another voice or to make it illegal to have a difference of opinion. And unfortunately, all these young people or people of this mindset who think, no, you can't believe what you believe. We are not going to tolerate that, and we're going to silence you. That's not democracy. That's not, you know, democracy is built on freedom of speech. And right now, that seems to be the little, what, the jingo block or whatever it is that seems to be pulling out. People want to pull that out. And if you do pull that out successfully, you will infect, you will affect a great catastrophic political upheaval. And the only thing I would say to the anarchists out there is that unless you already have a better form of government that you are ready to put into place, then you are playing with fire. You know, you need to really stop and think, oh yeah, you can destroy something. It's easy to destroy something, whether it's a work of art, whether it's somebody's home, or a political ideology. But if your ideology, if you do not have one that you can say this is far better than what America is, and again, America has lots of problems, America's not perfect, but in the wonderful words of Stephen Decatur, my country, may she always be right, but right or wrong, my country. Again, there are a lot of people that want to live here in America, but they don't want to be Americans. And that's the problem. That's the problem. So, I have some of my little notes here this morning. And I thought I'd share some of my ideas with you. And again, if you're already offended, get ready, because you're going to be more offended. Hold on a second. I got to get a tamper here. But these are just some observations that I have. Again, as we kind of try to go forward with our political process, broken as it is. Actually, the process isn't broken. You know, I could say if there had been true voting tampering, I mean, just blatant, you know, tampering where we realized that the election was fixed and rigged, I could see people legitimately say, hey, this was wrong. And I'd support that. And say, you know, because we want a fair election, okay? The best we can. But there's been no reports of any nefarious vote tampering going on, although there may be later down the road. I don't know. At the time of this recording, all it is a lot of disgruntled, angry young people who have nothing better to do than run out in the street and yell the F word. And he's not my president, you know. We're going to talk about that in just a minute. Isn't it interesting that comedians aren't laughing now? They're angry. They're not laughing. And but it's okay. If you're here in California, I mean, I don't see what the problem is. Okay, so Trump won. Big deal. You know, we live in California. And it doesn't matter now because you can smoke pot legally. You can fire that Mary Jane right up and no one's going to say anything now. You can go get stoned. I mean, come on. What a great, for some people, this is a perfect opportunity to really light up. So I'm just saying, I think people in California are missing the point. I mean, you guys, we guys, gals, you know, I mean, you should be celebrating, really. You should say, who won the presidency? Who cares? Give me some of that marijuana. Okay. Non-habit forming marijuana, by the way. Okay, so I'm just saying that comedians aren't laughing and people are token. So, you know, I don't see what the problem is there, really. Okay, glasses here. Okay. Another thing I thought was interesting. you always see the Hollywood elite types. They're saying that if so-and-so wins the election, and it, you know what? Trump and Clinton, these are just people that will go down the annals of history as one or two lines or maybe a paragraph, and that'll be the end of it, okay? You know, I remember when I was a younger person and Ronald Reagan got elected, and people were saying we were going to have World War III and Ronald Reagan was going to be the worst president of the world, the history of the United States. It turned out to be one of the best presidents of the United States. So, again, I don't know why people are so afraid. I do know why they're afraid, but they're being a bit ridiculous. But isn't it interesting that the Hollywood types who say they're going to leave the country, isn't it interesting? They all say they're going to Mexico, right? Wrong. They're going to a northern country called Canada. And guess what? Canada has very clear rules on immigration. You mean I just can't become a Canadian citizen if I want to? You can, but you have to go through the naturalization process. Okay? But I just thought it's interesting. They never want to go to Mexico. Why is that? Actually, I don't see why they don't want to go to Mexico, because a lot of our jobs went to Mexico. Thank you, NAFTA. Okay. Just saying. Okay. So, I wish them well. Wish them well. God bless them. Gonna miss you, but we'll make it without you. So, it says, okay, why did Catholics vote for Trump, you know, and not Hillary? Now, there's a lot of, this gets really interesting. I was gonna record this video on my phone, but I guess I didn't do that. So you're gonna have to make do with the video on the iPad here. I hope it's gonna be okay. So why did Catholics vote for Trump? And supposedly a little bit larger percentage of Catholics voted for Trump and not for Hillary. I would say that the reason why they voted for Trump and not Hillary was because Hillary made it very clear that certainly she was pro-choice. And I, as a Catholic, as I shared before, I can't vote for a pro-choice candidate. But Clinton basically waged war on the Catholics, evangelicals, Orthodox Jews, Orthodox Christians, by what she said here. And I got it right here on my iPhone. She said, talking about abortion rights, rights have to exist in practice, not just on paper. You know, Clinton was like, hey, you know what? If you have a right, then you have a right. And she says, laws have to be backed up with resources and political will. And deep-seated cultural codes, religious beliefs, and structural biases have to be changed. That's a throwing down of the gauntlet by Mrs. Clinton. So she kind of brought on herself why many Catholics thought, hey, you know what? Not only are you pro-choice, but now you're basically saying, I can't believe what I believe. Again, that overarching theme of freedom of conscience, freedom of speech, and freedom of belief. So, unfortunately, Hillary's words caused a lot of people of faith to be alarmed, and they voted their conscience, which was, sadly for her, was not for her. Okay. Let me ask you a question. What if, 8 years ago, when President-elect then, Obama, what if people went into the streets and were saying, F Obama, he's not my president, he's not my president. What would people do? They would say, you guys are racists. Now, that didn't happen. Now, maybe there were a few people who might have, you know, got on Twitter or maybe got on social media and said those things. But certainly we did not have the raucous, riotous, you know, riots in the streets that we're seeing now, which are turning violent. None of that happened. And I will tell you that as a person who did not vote for Barack Obama, again, because he was pro-choice, I was, the day of his inauguration, I was at work at the prison and I had to go check some mail. And I went to the mail room and a lot of our employees who were African Americans, actually had a, it was actually a pretty nice cultural cross-section of all, everybody, whites, blacks, Mexicans, Filipinos, you know, Hispanics, you know, anyway, bottom line was, it was just a good cross-culture, cross-cut of our culture, our device, our not divisive culture, but our diverse culture. Sometimes it might be a bit divisive. But anyway, so I could see that a lot of the American, black Americans there were just filled with a lot of pride and joy. And so when it came time for President Obama to take the oath of office, and it was kind of a moving moment, many of those black Americans began to stand. They began to stand. Now, because they wanted to symbolically, historically stand with him, literally, as he took that oath of office. Again, did I vote for him? No. Do I agree with his policies? Not at all. But I'm not trying to go against an individual, but I could sense that, you know what, the presidency is bigger than one person. And I said, you know what, I'm going to stand with him. And I did, you know, because I was celebrating American democracy and I did wish him well. I wanted him to be successful. I wanted him to have a change of heart, especially about life issues. How wonderful it would be if Democrats could be pro-life. That would just be awesome, you know, but unfortunately that's anathema to the Democratic platform. So, but I remember saying, okay, for the good of the country, to wish him goodwill instead of, you know, sitting on my ass and being disrespectful, which I thought, I don't know if I agree with this guy and his policies. I don't think I should do that. And it wasn't that I was afraid or intimidated, because I'm not. I probably, you know, as you probably know, I say what I say and believe what I believe, and I'm not shy about that. But I felt that it'd be kind of in bad taste not to stand with everybody else, or at least the people that were standing. I'd be kind of making a silent protest possibly, and it wasn't the time for that. It just wasn't. Give the man a chance, I thought. Give him a chance. Like I said, I hoped that he would have a change of heart and maybe kind of begin to see things differently. Obviously he didn't, but again, the people voted. And Mr. Obama will now be packing his bags and he'll be going and doing something else with his life. God bless him. We wish him well. But anyway, I'm just saying that had people taken to the streets after Barack Obama had been elected, people would cry racism, racism, racism. Another thing that I wanted to point out is everybody says that it's the fault of the religious right. It's the religious right that got Trump elected. How dare them? My dear friends, I have seen nothing in the last 6 months, last year, the media has been rubbing our nose, people that are of faith, rubbing our noses in the quote-unquote fact and the statistics that you don't matter anymore. Your opinion is in the dustbin of history. You are insignificant. You are irrelevant. There is no more Christian America. You are has-beens. You're over. Your time is over. So let me ask you a question, media, and those of you who were, you know, kind of following the media like the Pied Piper, you know, and whistling and, oh, isn't it wonderful? And Hillary's going to be elected. La, 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 la. Okay. Yeah, a lot of people were saying the Christian faithful people like Franklin Graham and other Christian, notable Christian speakers, are wrong. You know, they're wrong, and you guys are, your days are over. You know, nobody wants to hear what you have to say anymore. You can't have it both ways, folks. Either we're this evil, horrible block of you know, religious, powerful people that are trying to force our views and our opinions on people, or we're not. Okay, you got to make up your mind. Either we are irrelevant, insignificant, and we are no longer a majority, quote unquote. Then fine, but you can't have it both ways. So I really don't think that the religious right, quote unquote, or the religious conservatives put Trump in office. In fact, if you look at the voting, the polling data, it was really a cross-section of a lot of groups of people. Yes, religious people did turn out and vote. But can I say something that's going to offend a lot of you? A lot of those voters weren't old white dudes. A lot of those voters really were black people, Hispanic people, women. Oh gosh, women betrayed. I thought it was interesting that everybody was, at least the women, were going to Susan B. Anthony's grave and tombstone and putting "I voted" on her gravestone and tombstone because they were confident that Hillary was going to be the first elected woman. Sadly, they were wrong. But why were they wrong? Why did this election surprise so many people? You know, people want to blame racism. They want to blame the Ku Klux Klan. They want to blame, you know, whoever, you know. But the blame, dear friends, please, if you're angry, and you have a right to be angry, I'm not saying you don't have a right to be angry or disappointed, but blame the media. Blame the media that lied to you. The mainstream media lied to you. They were clearly partisan. The problem is that when I was growing up, the mainstream media tried their best not to be partisan, and they tried to be objective. Now, I know I'm talking about Fox News, balanced and fair. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about ABC, NBC, CBS, those first three channels. Now, maybe some of you don't remember this because you're so young, but that's all we had, basically. And then UHF channels came in. We thought that was really cool. Channel TV40 here in Sacramento, one of my favorites. You know, all creature features of Bob Wilkins, one of my favorite TV shows as a kid growing up. But again, we only had three major channels. Oh, and PBS, I'm sorry, and PBS. But basically, that was it. And I have to say that I never saw the blatant partisanship that we saw in this past election. If you're angry, be angry at CNN. Be angry at MSNBC. Be angry at, the other one I saw, and PBS. They unfortunately are pretty much, you know, NPR station affiliate. You know, all those, So again, and I love PBS, don't get me wrong, but unfortunately, politically, they are way out there flapping in the breeze right now on the left coast. So if you want to be angry, fine, be angry, but blame the media. They're the ones that you really need to have. You need to pick a bone with them, not with basic Americans throughout the country who voted their conscience and they voted. Okay. One of the things that I began to think that there's something wrong. There was something really, 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 really wrong. And what was that? When I would look at the media coverage, and everybody was in it for Hillary. Oh, Hillary this and, you know. And again, I'm not here to support Donald Trump and say what a great human being he is. I'm not saying that at all. But I am saying that the blatant partisanship that was shown by the mainstream media was so over the top. It was beyond the pale, beyond the pale. But the thing that made me start thinking was, okay, I would look at the alternate media, you know, the social media, and I kept seeing over and over and over and over and over again people coming out in support of Donald Trump. And not only that, I saw these huge, huge, huge crowds. I mean, that just, I kept thinking, wait a minute, what's wrong? I mean, everybody, and then you'd see the Hillary, Tim Kaine, crowds, and there's maybe a sprinkling of maybe a few hundred people here and there, maybe a couple hundred people, to Trump's thousands upon thousands. I did watch the last rally that he had in Michigan. I was actually touched by that. I didn't watch many of his rallies. I just watched little headlines here and there. But that Michigan rally was was, I have to say, I was moved by that. I was emotionally moved by his heart, his campaign spirit. And I just thought, wow, and look at all these, again, they have young people there too. It's not just a bunch of old white guys, but a lot of young people, black people, Hispanic people, women people, you know. So the bottom line was, it was a cross-cultural collection of all different demographics of people, not just one. So again, but if you're angry, be angry at the mainstream media. They're the ones who led you down the primrose path to delusion and despair. Okay, so let me just say this. People claim that Trump or his policies are racists. Racists, okay. But I would ask you a question. Racism has an inevitable teleological conclusion. You know what it is? It's extermination. That's what racism leads to, extermination. And I would submit to you something that might shock you and maybe even infuriate you more. Real racism, believe it or not, can be seen in what goes on every day at Planned Parenthood. And Margaret Sanger, who started Planned Parenthood, do you realize Planned Parenthood was started because as we moved into the 20th century, we realized that, you know, maybe lynching people isn't a good idea, but maybe we can get rid of black people another way. Maybe we just abort them. Margaret Sanger started Planned Parenthood as a true racist foundation, and it even continues today. So all I'm just saying is that real racism leads to extermination, and you can see that alive and well at Planned Parenthood every day. Let's see here. Got a couple more. Yeah. So all I'm saying is that abortion is built upon racism. And I already alluded to this, but basically it was diversity, believe it or not, diversity that put Trump in the White House, not just a bunch of old angry white guys. Now, I want to say this, I'm going to conclude with this one thing, but first, let me light my pipe here. Got my purple lighter here. Purple lighter. Kind of a symbolic gesture to try to say, bringing the country together, you know, red and blue states make purple, so let's try to come together, folks. And the last thing I want to say is, yes, this was a good thing for conservatives, good thing for conservative people. And I'll tell you why. Because it validates the fact that we still have a place at the table and we still have a voice. Because in the last few years, we have basically been told, go to the back of the bus or get out of this country or shut up. We are not going to listen to you anymore. That's what we've been told. Let me ask you, if I said that to, say, people in the Black Lives Matter movement, or say people in the LGBTQPRSTUV movement, you know, shut up, we're not going to listen to you anymore. Everybody would scream, that's racism, that's some kind of ism, right? It's a phobia, whatever. But people have gotten away with saying it's okay to discriminate against conservatives. And my friends, that's wrong. Sorry, but it's wrong. If it's wrong for me to discriminate and tell you to shut up and we're not going to listen to you anymore, it's equally as wrong for you to tell me and other conservative people that we don't have a voice and you don't have a place at the table anymore. This election says that yes, we do. Now, we are in a contentious, very bitter war of words right now. I hope it will just remain there. Unfortunately, I'm a little concerned that people might get really violent over this whole election. I hope that doesn't happen. I hope that calmer minds will prevail. Voices of reason will sound out the voices of anger and calls to to social unrest and anarchy. We hope and pray that that will be the case. But again, folks, we have basically, I think this is a real reaction to the fact that one group of people have been truly discriminated against, and they have decided that they are going to quietly say, no, sorry, this is our country too, and we have a right to speak our minds. Well, I spoke mine, and if you want to leave a comment, please do so. I'd like to hear what you have to say. Thanks for watching. Again, like and subscribe. We really appreciate it if you would. And I really appreciate you taking time to watch the video. And we'll see you next time. I have probably a MacBook Pro video coming up. Got some nice little surprises there I wanted to share with you all. But we'll make that video another time. All right. So, again, happy Veterans Day. And God bless the United States of America. And God bless you. Take care. And light up your world. Light up your pipe, too, if you haven't done so already. Oh, I hope I turned this on.